But I thought we would get started. I know there's, for some folks, studio and other things that are going on this afternoon, but I just want to say welcome. My name is Mabel Wilson. I'm a professor here at the Graduate School of Architecture Planning and Preservation, otherwise known affectionately now as GSAPP. I just want to say this is going to be a sort of presentation of, I would just say, at this point, it's still ongoing work because we started the projects kind of in the middle, but it's an advocacy project called Who Builds Your Architecture, or as we affectionately call it, WBYA, sort of like a radio station. And it's a group of architects, scholars, students, you know, wear many hats, but we deploy the tools, methods and approaches of architecture to probe and evaluate how the process of building locally and globally impacts the work and life conditions of those who build our architecture. So as I said, we're academics and scholars and designers and curators and writers and students who advocate for fair labor practices on job sites around the world. And I just want to introduce my collaborators. I'm going to do that now. And also say a few things and then introduce our participants today as well for joining us for further conversation. Kadambari Baxi, who is an architect and professor at Barnard, who's widely published and exhibited work sits at the intersection of media, technology, architecture, urbanism, and politics, Jordan Carver. The writer, educator, as you don't know, he is a contributing editor, founder of the Avery Review. He's a doctoral student in American Studies and also a graduate of our M.Arch and our CCCP program here. Laura Diamond Dixit, she's a writer. She's also a doctoral candidate here at GSAPP. And also co-founder of Kamara.
Is that Kamara?
Kamara. Projects. here in Brooklyn and at the Duke. Tiffany Rattray, who is here in front, she is a GSAPP graduate, where I'm proud to say she received the top honor of the McKim Prize in her class and currently working at Tack Studio in Brooklyn. We're unfortunately not able to be joined for Lindsey Wikstrom Lee, who is also a very recent GSAPP graduate, recipient also of the McKim Prize last year, and of the prestigious SOM Traveling Fellowship. I wish I could say Lindsey was out there doing her work in China, but she apologizes, she has a deadline at Gang Studios today, so she couldn't join us. So today we're going to present our advocacy work and research, and we're officially launching our critical field guide, which you can find on whobuilds.org. Switch that. Oh, there we go. Okay. Here we go. And you can find a critical field guide at whobuilds.org, and it's available for download. And so it's really a combination of, I believe at this point, almost 6 years of on the ground and field research. So along the way, we've collaborated with many people, and we do want to say a special thanks to Glenn Cummings, Elisa Dizek, Michaela Povaleri at MTWTF, who worked with us on early exhibitions and also on the critical field guide specifically. We want to give a special thanks to GSAPP as a whole because it's been supportive, the university's president's office for the amazing grant we received, and also Dean Amale, Andraos, for the ongoing support of this project. Joining us are a few of our interlocutors in this advocacy project. Andrew Ross, who is sitting on the end, is a professor of social and cultural analysis at NYU. Andrew is the author of more than a dozen books, countless articles, and editorials on the changing nature of work, urban life, and our shared ecologies. He's a founding member of Golf Labor, which is very important, and I'll explain why, and Golf Ultra Labor Faction. His most recently edited book, actually this isn't the most, this is the one before his recently edited book, The Golf, High Culture and Hard Labor, probes the low ball labor practices underwriting the high stakes real estate gamble behind the signature architect of Saadiyat Island in Abu Dhabi. Andrew's participation in our early forums, our workshops and also a contributor to the Critical Field Guide. We're also fortunate to be joined by Phil Bernstein at AIA, who's an architect and a professor at Yale University. Until 2 months ago, he was the VP at Autodesk, leading strategic industry relations, in other words, charting the vision for new emerging practices in the field of architecture. He writes and lectures extensively about practice, product delivery, and technology, with a focus on questions of the future of labor, both in the office and on site. He edited with Peggy Diemer, Building in the Future, Recasting Labor in Architecture. And then we're also joined by Amale, Andraos, who's the Dean of GSAPP, Principal of Work AC. Her recently published collection, The Arab City, Architecture and Representation, offers a critical perspective on the varied landscape of architecture and urbanism, one that includes questions of politics of labor and work. Amale joined our first workshop 3 years ago and is a contributor also to the Critical Field Guide. So, Builds Your Architecture, that's our logo, WBYA. And really what we started with were questions. It really started with a conversation that Kadambari and I had at a dinner that was sponsored by GSAPP. And you know, we were not experts in this area, but we had questions about it, and I'll explain why. So we were inspired by Gulf Labor's petition launched in the spring of 2011. Their effort raised awareness of the human rights violations that were taking place in Saadiyat Island, a large-scale development project in Abu Dhabi, where the Guggenheim Foundation was planning to construct a new multi-million dollar design museum designed by American architect Frank Gehry. Nagari's transcendent design would help the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi, according to their website, quote, contribute to a more inclusive and expansive view of art history that emphasizes the convergence of local, regional, and international sources of creative inspiration rather than geography or nationality, quote. But a backlash quickly ensued. Artists, curators, and theorists whose work we admire because of their radical stances on social and political issues had signed a petition. Some were friends and colleagues, like Andrew Ross and Wally Broad. The signatories, many were artists based in the Middle East, refused to cooperate and collaborate with the new Guggenheim or any other branch unless contractual guarantees were offered from the foundation that would protect the rights of workers employed in the construction maintenance of its new branch museum in Abu Dhabi. That's part of the that's part of the petition. However, we noticed something unusual about the petition. Among the list of signatories was not one was an architect. We scanned the media and the Argosphere, but no outrage or debate had erupted about the dire conditions and the human rights violations of construction workers. Any sort of critical commentary about the workers who would build the $800 million, 450,000 square foot behemoth along the Persian Gulf was nowhere to be found. We drafted our own petition, but that quickly faded as we realized that architects enter and work within the system in different ways than artists. We needed other strategies to ask other types of questions. So with that in mind, over the last 6 years, we've been directing the question, who builds your architecture? To professional organizations, to architectural firms, to architects, to students, activists, I can report that it's been highly met, at least initially, with silence or polite evasion. Those architects who did respond to our initial query often cited contractual constraints as the reason why they had no power to intervene in the exploitation of workers involved in constructing their designs. This rationale categorically cast the problem's responsibility outside the purview of the profession. This is Saadiyat Island. I mean, this kind of gives you a sense of the context. That's Gehry, Jean Duvel, I mean, you're all architects, you know the icons, right? So we've been working on this project, and then lo and behold, this also echoed the response by now the late architect Zaha Hadid, when the Guardian newspaper asked the Pritzker Prize winning designer in February of 2014 to comment on the deaths of migrant workers on Qatar's construction sites, where she had been commissioned to design the flagship stadiums for FIFA's World Cup. Now her project was not under construction at the point. So what she said was, quote, I have nothing to do with the workers. She observed quickly and transferred responsibility for their plight to the authority of the state. Quote, I think that is an issue the government, if there is a problem, should pick up. Hopefully these things will be resolved. Hadid has expressed her deep concern over the deaths in the Iraq War, but asserted that just as she could not intervene in that conflict, architects like her were not obligated to guarantee the fair treatment of construction workers. I don't take it lightly, she added, but I think it's for the governments to take care of. It's not my duty as an architect to look at it. Hadid's choice of the word duty illustrates the risk of adversity and class divisions that characterize the prevailing mentality of the construction and design industries. Like many of her defenders, she's highlighting the fact that the architect's contractual obligations are at the service of the project's owner and do not extend to the contractors and the workers engaged in realizing their designs. While this might seem to be a technical distinction, it shields architects from claims that they have any sort of legal responsibilities towards construction workers. The word duty points to the very carefully defined accountability that minimizes the risk to architects and insulates them over the course of the construction process, at least ideally. But it also evokes the perceived class distinctions drawn between the intellectual labor, the design professional, and the physical labor necessary to erect the building. Hadid is one of many prominent architects and firms of various sizes working on projects in countries whose governments have poor records on human rights and labor laws. As mentioned, Gary, another Pritzker Prize winner, has long been the focus of Gulf labor's criticism. Let Andrew pick up on that one. As the architect for the Guggenheim Museum in Abu Dhabi, in contrast with Hadid, Gary hired Scott Horton, a prominent human rights lawyer, to consult about protecting the well-being and rights of workers constructing the Guggenheim project. But on the other hand, Gary has readily admitted that, as far as ideal clients go, perhaps, quote, the best thing is to have a benevolent dictator who has taste, end quote. So the agency of the architect, by definition, is a delicate balance. Unlike artists, architects are hired not just for their creativities and design capabilities, but also in a service role of interpreting and executing a project within a framework of established by a client's needs and desires. At the same time, international scale projects, often presented as cultural centerpieces for the city or state, garner international prestige by exploiting the image of so-called starchitects, and thus provide a platform for architects to expand their role beyond formmaker, problem solver, and service provider. But we cannot expect architects to shoulder this responsibility alone, or to resolve the ethical challenges that arise from these outside projects. In their effort to ensure treatment of the migrant construction workers building the Guggenheim Museum in Abu Dhabi, the artists and activists of Gulf labor have shown that many points of pressure are needed to shift the networks that coordinate all of the actors and resources in building large-scale projects. In alignment with the Gulf labor campaign, Who Builds Your Architecture asks how architects can be the most effective in bettering the conditions of workers employed in building their designs. To better understand the how, we needed to understand the what and why and probe the vast terrain of what we call the global supply chain of the construction industry to find the linkages between architects and construction workers. So this is just an excerpt of some of the things that we've been working on. So these are from various things that we've actually published about this. So who builds? Over the past two decades, the construction of large-scale architectural and infrastructural projects around the world has proceeded at a dizzying pace. And even today, as the construction boom may or may not be showing signs of regional and even a global slowdown, transnational construction projects remain a cornerstone of the global economy, one that's clearly in a moment of recalibration, as we speak. To better understand these kinds of declarations by leading architects, we realized we needed to better understand how the global supply chain of the construction industry produces buildings. Not simply how buildings are conceived by architects, but also how they are materialized by a network that mobilizes architects, construction workers, and a host of other actors. This required an approach that deploys the representational tools and techniques of architecture, along with a critical analysis that explains and makes visible architecture's entanglements with geopolitical and economic structures. WBYA's investigations ask, where is architecture within these circuits, and what various actions might architects take to better the conditions under which workers build? So, with the growth and accumulation and intensification of globalization, accumulation of capitalism, regardless of the definition, urbanization in various regions of the world has functioned as a lucrative lucrative terrain for surplus capital generation, a growth facilitated by the internationalization of finance markets. The property market, writes David Harvey, has absorbed a great deal of surplus capital through new construction. So that's the economics of what's happening. For the cycle of capital accumulation to generate additional wealth through large-scale building projects, a substantial workforce employed over the course of several years of the construction process is needed. If the local pool of labor is too small, especially for projects requiring an army of workers, thousands strong, then private contractors or state authorities draft the labor pool from migrant and immigrant populations who live elsewhere. So these are examples of these kinds of large-scale constructions. And so these are some of the sites that we've actually looked at. So on building sites in places like Saudi Arabia, Abu Dhabi, or Doha, Qatar, for example, construction workers are being recruited from all parts of the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and Northern Africa. According to Amnesty International, there are more than 1.535 million nationals working in Qatar, a country home to approximately 250,000 citizens. Since migrant workers are not citizens of the nations in which they work, they have very few rights. There are very few avenues available for abused workers to protest poor treatment, even though many have committed to a multi-year labor contract. Construction workers often face unscrupulous conduct by recruitment firms, subcontractors, and also local authorities. Persistent problems with the recruitment process can involve exorbitant fees, for example, charged for recruitment firms, and false representations of the type of work and compensation that workers are to receive. Employers can confiscate passports to prevent flight, or deliberately fail to issue proper identification cards that allow workers to move freely around the city. And migrant workers are also subject to dangerous and at times deadly conditions on job sites. In the worst case scenarios, workers live in poorly maintained and substandard accommodations located in sprawling worker camps. Companies construct these camps at the outskirts of cities, far from job sites and areas where the amenities can be easily accessed. The workers' camp results in the segregation of a large population of men outside the civic and economic life of a city that they are actively constructing. This separation produces the dual effect that keeps workers from integrating into the social and cultural life of a host city and curtails the establishment of migrant-owned businesses that might fuel additional movement of men and women to a particular city or region. Their isolation and lack of political agency also stifles political reforms that would open host nations to more immigration and the creation of immigrant communities that would form outside the purview of limited employment contracts. So this is kind of the scale and scope of the project that we recognized. And so because of the challenges posed by the jurisdictional differences between the nation states where migrant workers come from and the countries where they end up working, human rights and international labor organizations have been systematically challenging the legalities of the current recruitment system found in many parts of the world. A process of cross-border movement, one with racial and ethnic undertones, has grown even more fraught and complicated with the recent spate of protectionist moves as market forces recalibrate. The law is clearly the primary area in which to intervene and abolish exploited dimensions within the current system. However, many of the problems that we've now realized through this research that migrant construction workers face are inherently spatial, urban, and architectural in nature. And in order to understand these problems, we need to make them visible within the complex networks and systems that they exist within. And this has been the project of WBYA. So we're going to now talk specifically about what we've been up to.
So thank you, Mabel, and thank you all for coming. There are a few WBYers, as I see people who participated in our workshops, etc., panelists who've been part of previous events, and it's really a pleasure to see many new faces and students here. So I will just talk a little bit, and this is a bit of a relay race, as you'll see. All the WBYA members, core members, are going to speak, and we're going to go a bit faster now. So last 5 years, we've done forums, panels, workshops, exhibitions, which, and this is also a bit of a timeline here. So the first panel we did was at the Viralist Center at New School. And Andrew Ross and Reinhold Martin both participated in that. And this really came out of our first discussion and the petition that was circulated, as Mabel mentioned, by Gulf River Coalition. And this was really supposed to be one panel. That was what all we were going to do. And then that really started a spawn, it really spawned a kind of now almost 6 years of discussions and events. And I wanted to just share a short clip from Bill Van Asfeld, who's from Human Rights Watch.
I mean, the United Arab Emirates, 90% of the population is foreign and will never be given citizenship, and many of them are construction workers who will, you know, they have very little ability to advocate for their rights. An awareness of the entire context of who's involved in this activity that you as an architect are helping to get off the ground. And so I think it would be useful just to bring this down to a very human level, who built your architecture, to just imagine yourself as you're from a Southeast Asian country. Maybe the majority are now coming from Bangladesh. These are people who may never have left their village. They tend to speak an incredible number of languages, but Arabic and English are not among them. You have very little chance of ever pulling yourself out of poverty if you stay where you are. So you've heard about an opportunity to go to the rich Gulf and work for a few years, and then come back home and, you know, you could buy property, you could invest, you could, you know, don't have to go to the Grameen Bank. You've got your own money. And the way you've heard to get there is to go to a city, and you go to a labor supply agency who says, well, we'll get you there, but you're going to have to pay us, say, $3,000, $2,500, $3,000. That's more money than you've ever seen in your life, and you don't have it. So you sell your wife's gold jewelry, you mortgage your small house, and you collect all the money you can from your relatives. Maybe you get $1,000. You need to go to a moneylender. The money lender, because you have no real collateral, you can't go to a bank, even the Grameen Bank. And so you take out a loan from a money lender at 10% per month interest. You don't sign a contract, or maybe you sign a contract, or maybe you just sign your name on a blank piece of paper in your home country. Then you wind up in Abu Dhabi or the Dubai airport, and you get sent to Abu Dhabi. There you sign a different contract, written in Arabic and English, which you don't understand, which may be completely different from what you thought you were doing. It may not only be a different job. I met people who thought they were going to be working, cooking food for people in a hotel, because the name of the construction site was the name of a hotel, but they wound up building the hotel for about a third of the money that they were promised. The average was often 50% less than you were promised by this labor sending agency in your home country, was what you actually wound up getting paid. So now you're on the work site. You may not be happy. You're there for about 3 years. You know, maybe you're being underpaid. Maybe you're being paid late. Maybe working conditions are poor. Maybe your housing conditions are poor. But you really have no recourse, because you owe money to the guy who lent it to you. and you are going to have to work for whatever it is that you've been offered. You can't unionize to demand better treatment. You also can't switch employers, because your work visa is limited to that specific employer. So if you quit, you are illegally present in the country. And it would be difficult to quit anyway because the employer has your passport. So if you quit, you'll be deported. If you try and get a new job, you'll be deported. Some people do quit and work for other employers, but only the most unscrupulous employers who'd be willing to take the risk to employ you, and in exchange for taking that risk, they're going to exploit you even worse and pay you even less. So that's the sort of broad sphere. I mean, that's the whole sort of human story that one needs to think of and that one needs to capture when one thinks about one's risk.
So this sort of human story has been collected in many different types of reports from Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International. And so part of the project when we've been doing these panels and exhibition was just to put these reports in front of everyone, but also sort of keep repeating these stories again and again from different people. We also started looking at within the discipline what kind of documents or mechanisms exist to start addressing these issues. So the first document was the Code of Ethics for Architects that's put together by the American Institute of Architects and hasn't been revised, as far as I know, in many years. And here you'll see just a quick demonstration. In talking about issues of sustainability, there have been a lot of issues discussed and clauses that are addressed to environmental sustainability. So even in the Code of Ethics as it stands now, you see three clauses that address environmental sustainability, but you see a very tiny little really generic statement about human rights and human sustainability. So our first move, and this was kind of an image we produced, which was also sent to the Gulf Labor 52 weeks campaign action that they produced, was just very simple, but in the ethics or professional code of ethics, how do we expand the clauses of human rights? That led to a series of workshops. As we kept getting deeper and deeper, we realized that this issue has to be covered from many different angles. We did, some of the workshoppers are here, we did two workshops at the Studio X in New York. We also did workshops in Mumbai, in Stockholm, in Istanbul. There was a workshop in Venice that Mabel and Phillip. We're both there. And so just to say that this is an ongoing conversation, and a lot of issues keep coming up again and again, and I'll just mention a couple. So one thing is, this, by the way, in this picture is Mitch McEwen, who's also an alum of GSAPP, now teaches in Michigan and has her own practice. And I think her group worked on this idea of just building council. A kind of a professional body. She almost had a business plan actually for the Just Building Council, but how a kind of a professional body could start addressing some of these questions. Before I go to the exhibition, I'll just mention two other things that came out in other workshops. In Stockholm, there was a group from Women in Building Association, that is a group of network of professionals who are architects, urban planners, and construction workers. And what they mentioned was the issue of wage discrepancy, especially on construction site. As in Sweden, in Stockholm, you have more and more immigrant workers. Workers coming from Romania, Poland, but now increasingly from Syria, even on smaller job size, residential home building sites, there's an incredible wage discrepancy between Swedish workers and on the same website, on construction site, and immigrant workers. And not only was this was something was there quite in open, what they really brought up the question was that this was what can be done with that information? And they really felt that there should be a professional body or somebody who this information could be reported to, but also something that can be regulated by some organization. This issue also came in Mumbai by sociologist Professor Sharif Balmik, who I very recently learned passed away, so I'm very sad to hear that. But he's a very well-known labor activist, and he worked on policies for formalization of street vendors. And this was an issue he brought up, that these policies that are written often in academic settings or with NGOs, the policies need to filter to various levels of actors who are involved in these kind of projects. And again, for professionals to participate in these policies or even make sense of these policies, he strongly believed that a neutral, non-governmental, professional organization could be a best sort of a body that can bring many different actors to table, but also be translate these policies to different levels of people who engage these processes. So some of this work then also became a form of exhibition, where it was a challenge to communicate these complex web of issues in different contexts. The first time it was exhibited was at the Istanbul Design Biennial, not this last year, but the one before 2014, which was curated by Zoe Ryan. And the theme of the biennial was "The future is not what it used to be," and they had put a call out for manifestos. And our manifestos, we submitted a manifesto which was simply this one question: who builds your architecture? And really looking at it as a double-sided question, where one side of the question really goes outwards and looks at the global networks that are come together to build global projects, but also then looks inside to our discipline and looks at questions of ethics and design and new technologies to see how those questions might be addressed. So the installation itself was a large table where the discussions could go around, and what you see on the wall are what we call action posters. On the table is a large global network drawing that Tiffany will explain. That exhibition went with the same curator, is now at the Chicago Art Institute, and this is in a common in a space that is the Torokawa Gallery, that is right next to the cafe, if some of you are familiar with the Art Institute, just to say that it gets a lot of general public audience. So the challenge here was to then communicate all these complex issues to a general audience, and here you see a similar sort of a setup where on one wall is the global network of a fictional architectural project, showing architects and architectural documents going from one side to a construction side in the middle, and then the workers coming from the other side. And then on the facing wall is another interface that we've developed through Graph Commons, which looks at specific case studies in Chicago, New York, Istanbul, and Doha, where we've selected projects in these cities and just looked at the building facade and tried to map all the networks, of consultants and contractors, etc., that are associated with that one particular building and element. And that is something Laura is going to show further. And so I'll pass it on to Tiffany.
So this drawing was used across both of the exhibitions that Kadambari just spoke about, one in Istanbul and in Chicago, it's currently up. We used drawings to relate architects to the workers through the construction site. So we begin to realize how isolated the world of people who design buildings, the architects, is from the people who build the buildings, the laborers. This drawing operates at multiple scales. At a territorial scale, the urban form of an imagined metropolis in the United States is compared to a city in the Middle East and to a village in mainland Asia. Building materials and workers are contextualized across different landscapes in their journey to the site. A series of axonometrics and perspectives are superimposed on the drawing that document the way in which villagers become laborers. They leave their families and move abroad to work on large construction sites. Simultaneously, the life of an architectural detail is described, and the detail and the laborer meet on site in this drawing. So on one side, you can see the office where the architect and engineer are working to design the truss. The truss is then manufactured and shipped overseas to the job site. At the same time, workers from small villages attend training camps in nearby cities where they learn construction trades and obtain foreign work permits, often at their own expense. Both the building materials and workers arrive at the site where finally the labor power of the two parties come into contact. The drawing demonstrates the architect's responsibility to the worker. Each party is connected through the building itself. Architects and engineers should advocate for the safety of those who realize their visions. While we don't often see this relationship while sitting at our desks in our offices downtown, it's important to be aware of this responsibility even from a distance. These are a series of posters that we developed that are positive propaganda, enabling architects to become stewards of the good labor practice. The posters call for architects to expand their observations on site to include keeping an eye on conditions. They also ask architects to adopt new nomenclature to describe global building practices. Beyond this new lexicon, the posters call for an expansion of the AIA's code of ethics to ensure basic protections and rights of workers. And they call for a realignment of technologies in order to make architects more aware of the global impact of their work, as well as make construction documents that better inform laborers of how to complete their job safely.
So I'll be going through discussing the database that was in our Chicago exhibition. And we worked on the database over the summer. This was after we had done sort of over a number of years worked on the long drawings that Tiffany was going through. And this was a bit of a shift for us. Those drawings, the previous drawings that you just saw, those were more diagrammatic, more sort of abstract or based on relationships that do unfold around the construction site. But here we're really looking at very specific relationships. So looking at the sort of different companies and different entities that are involved in building projects. So this is this was a collaboration with Graph Commons, who's based in Istanbul and I think here in New York as well. So there's a screen in the exhibition, and this is the, you can also find this online, so if any of you, and there's links through our website, so if any of you want to look at this later. We started with an Excel spreadsheet and wanted to really track relationships only through facades on buildings that were in these four cities, in Doha, Chicago, New York, and Istanbul. So it's a really sort of dense web after accumulating all this data. But one of the things that sort of came up again and again was that there was just very little information on the workers themselves. So the sort of maybe lack of visibility of workers in cities, or the questions around citizenship, those in a way in the data, there's a sort of inequality where there's much information that you can find for particular buildings on various contractors and subcontractors, but information on the workers is largely missing. So that's where you see here this question mark is sort of just asking, you know, where is this data? Because certainly, you know, these the data is missing. So one thing that I'll just quickly say before passing this off to Jordan is that in addition to sort of seeing that there's this lack of data around workers, one of the other things that was sort of interesting to discover is that sort of labor histories that are associated with each building. So if you think each project has a labor history. And so for one World Trade Center, for example, and you can click on the project and then information comes up. So since it was difficult, you know, in architectural journals and sort of information online to find specific information about the workers, we went to other sources. So the New York Times for the World Trade Center, the New York Times had this really interesting piece where it was a feature and it showed many of the workers who had been involved in building one World Trade Center and some of, you know, what their experiences were, but also listed the various unions that were involved in building. So we went through and took the unions, you know, Local 1, Local 28, Local 3, and then put that into the database. So it was a process of sort of seeing the lack of data around labor within our discipline, but then also looking to some other sources to try to fill that in and sort of add information where we could. So.
Hi, thanks for being here. I'm going to be the last WBYA speaker, and I'm going to talk just really briefly about some of the publications we've done. So along with our exhibitions, WBYA has tried to publish our work through a broad array of publications. To date, this has included essays not just on our work, but also book chapters and research-driven publications, writings, various issues that motivate our project. We published with Andraos and Wolf Labor, Architecture, Lobby, Books on Labor and Visual Culture in the Middle East, and fairly recently, a website, Eflux. Each of these venues has allowed us to project, has allowed our project to circulate within several different contexts, from architecture to the activist to the academic and beyond, to wide audiences within the art and cultural production communities. It has been important for us that our work maintain academic rigor with a research focus, but can speak to different audiences and move between multiple disciplines at the same time. In short, knowing that the problems that we are questioning are highly complex and the solutions are far from obvious, we want to address as broad an audience as possible in ways that are clear and open to critique and dialogue. Our latest publication, which is now available to download and share easily, is the WBYA Critical Field Guide. And it acts as a primer to the issues of architecture, migrant labor exploitation, much of what we've been talking about this afternoon. The field guide introduces key terms, asks key questions, has case studies, and presents proposals that locate architecture within the complex transnational networks of contemporary building and construction. Connects problems faced by the global systems of design and construction to the workers who exist and labor within them. Like all our projects, the field guide employs representational tools and techniques of architecture, along with critical analysis to explain and make legible architecture's entanglements with the vast geopolitical and economic structures of contemporary design and construction. And importantly, the field guide offers proposals for best practices, ideas for action, and resources for more in-depth study on the issues and challenges affecting workers worldwide. Tiffany presented some of the key ones that we've been developing. The guide begins with redefining a lexicon of terms in order to help us organize a larger dialogue for the project and serves to bring a variety of different voices. the glossary of architectural terms begins to question how we as architects, planners, and designers talk about the issues pertaining to migrant workers in the global architecture profession. So highlighting what terms like recruitment fee might mean both to the migrant worker, but also what it means with our own practices and what it might mean as we kind of do drawings and bid on jobs and how those buildings are actually constructed. And so within this discourse that we're trying to establish, we draw on case studies and try to map out global connections between architectural practice and material production and global construction. Make explicit links between sending countries such as Nepal and receiving countries such as Qatar and how workers travel within and between them. We investigate the networks of human capital and flows that lead workers from rural farm-based economies to construction training programs in urban areas and finally to construction sites abroad. And here, some field research that Laura has done in Nepal. We look at how global logistics and standards organizations have created platforms that allow materials to be sized, sorted, and shipped from anywhere to anywhere. And we question why internal labor standards have been denied the same attention. If a screw pitch can be standardized across the world, then surely more attention can be given to international labor standards that have been established but may not be implemented with such rigor as other building standards. And so one of the main goals behind the guide was to make available the many voices that have participated in our events and our workshops over the years, and the many methods of action they have suggested. From redefining the design process to better integrating the workers at the other end of the drawings to improving methods for site safety and observation and fundamentally shifting what agency means in the client architect contractor relationship. The guide offers both concrete goals and further avenues for research and investigation. And on that note, one thing we are currently developing is a more city or state-specific, state-specific pamphlet on working conditions and worker organizing in Istanbul. We've been collaborating with architects, union representatives, lawyers to gather information and present architectural strategies for addressing specific issues concerning worker rights in Istanbul, Turkey. And this can mean more fully articulating the very complex construction and labor laws in the country, like infinitely complex to the point where architects, more laborers, more contractors seem to really have full grasp of what governs who and how those laws are implemented, much less what happens if those laws are broken. And then another option, or another thing we look at is how to stage a construction site to provide migrant housing. A lot of migrant workers come to Istanbul from Syria and the broader Middle East and from eastern Turkey in the Kurdistan populations. So last time we were in Istanbul, one of the construction unions was on strike for back pay. Due to the nature of construction contracts, subcontractors often go unpaid, and so their workers stop working and then on strike. We have a short video that I'll play, it's about a minute long, just to show kind of what the scene looked like. So this was in Eastern Istanbul, was kind of a new development project, sort of condo project. An unknown architect rather than a contractor. So a very, very typical project that is starting all over Istanbul. So these workers, many of them from Eastern Turkey, hadn't been paid for months, and so they collect rates for this day. So ultimately, this strike was a success. The contractors met them, and they agreed to give them full back pay by the end of the working day, so long as they went back to work and they did. And it was tense, but it seemed to be one avenue of protest. So Istanbul and Turkey, of course, are more relevant case studies due to the high numbers of Syrian refugees currently in Turkey and the large Kurdish population that migrates to and from Istanbul on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. So these workers live on construction sites and that are often in the process of being built. And many similar issues, migration due to war, immigrant labor, and national identity that are facing these workers are, of course, ones that we are facing in our own country right now, not just because of the recent ban on migrants and visitors and refugees, but of course, we now have a developer and self-proclaimed builder in the White House. And not to give any undue attention to that person, I just think it's a good time for us to be asking these questions, how architects can begin to address these issues of global migration and inequality, and keep asking who builds our architecture. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to our guests, and I believe Andrew is going to say something first.
Well, first of all, I want to say that WBYA is pretty awesome. And really inspiring how you carry this project so far, and I really do hope that Dean Andraos and the faculty here at the school are able to promote and push this initiative as far as they can into the profession, because this really is doing the right thing at the right time and in the right place. And so for the past several years, WBYA has been working kind of in tandem with the Gulf Labor Coalition, which I helped found. And really, one of the common point of origin, as you picked up, was this opportunity, and I put it that way, quite in a sort of utilitarian fashion, this opportunity that arose for us to put pressure on the high-profile cultural institutions that we're building in Abu Dhabi. And in order to try and raise labor standards for the region as a whole, but the formula which was used for this actually originated much earlier in the 1990s in the anti-sweatshop movement, which targeted high-profile garment brands in a way that threatened to tarnish those brands so that they would take responsibility for what happened further down the production line. And unlike garment factories, architect design cultural institutions, buildings at least, are very difficult to move overnight when you shine the spotlight on abuses that occur on site. In addition, unlike Nike and The Gap, cultural institutions have moral value that's built into their brands. And lastly, they're also different because they have internal constituencies of conscience, by which I mean, faculty, students, artists, performers, curators, architects, who can build up pressure from below upon leadership of the institutions at the top. And for sure, yes, architects of note can stand to have their reputation sullied by association with human rights abuses. And in the course of our campaigns, we did actually try to engage with some of the top-level architects that were involved in commissions on Sadia Island, Rafael Vignoli and Jean Nouvel, designing the Louvre, Vignoli did the NYU campus, and Frank Gehry, who designed, produced the design for the Guggenheim Museum. We didn't get any responses from the offices of the first two, and as Mabel described, there was some dialogue with a legal representative from Frank Gehry's office. And in addition, Gehry himself publicly on a radio show, I think it was the Leonard Lopez show, did actually claim that there was language in his contract about fair labor standards. But since he chose not to make that language public, we only have his word for it. Now, you also learned today that the AIA's code of ethics does contain a passing reference to upholding human rights. But in practice, that discussion really has never really strayed very far from the, you know, the Albert Speer question, which applies to instances where an architect is directly in complicity with an authoritarian regime. And it's a matter of debate what difference there is between the Third Reich and the benevolent dictators that, again, that Frank Gehry invoked and Mabel mentioned earlier on. But there was a kind of flare-up of this question locally, I think, in the fall, when the AIA's Robert Ivey, is that his name? Robert Ivey very warmly extended commitment on the part of the profession to the Trump administration to work hand in glove in fulfilling contracts for new infrastructure projects. And the backlash to those comments was very loud and very righteous and very good, and he had to walk back the statement. But it's difficult to imagine comparable clamor that might arise in the case of gross violations of labor rights, which is something perhaps to think about. And part of the reason, of course, is that architects generally are well insulated from the fallout that can come from exposure with human rights or labor rights abuses on construction sites and material supply lines. Legal liability generally is not does not lie with it lies with the contractor, and not even moral responsibility. Public perception that I'm not even moral responsibility is in the corner of architects. And you would think that public perception at least has shifted a little in the wake of the widespread commentary surrounding Zaha Hadid's comments concerning conditions in Qatar. And there was indeed a moment, an opportunity for a notable architect to stand up and offer himself or herself as a counterpoint to Hadid and that position associated with Hadid, but no one really did. And that was unfortunate, or not to my knowledge, at least no one has done so far. And maybe that's just a sad reflection of how much of the profession is still beholden to the gravy train of contracts that are flowing from the construction booms in the Gulf states and East Asia. But let me just conclude by saying, addressing the issue of what is the solution here. Obviously, Mabel's already alluded to this, the solution is not solely something that architects can bring about. For sure, it would be wonderful if architects of good conscience were to step forward and publicly take those pledges and declare themselves as the alternative to Hadid. But what's needed is something in the long term that involves a network of professional and trade groups that can work together, that can forge a kind of master agreement that covers the whole chain. That WBYA has mapped out so in such a useful fashion, so that you have the whole, you know, design to build chain and an agreement that covers each point, so that there are no gaps in the chain, at which point deniability can pop up, and that's the point at which the responsibility ends. People can say, "I'm not responsible for what happens below below me," and. Well, what are the precedents for that kind of network? Obviously, the Bangladesh, in the garment industry, the Bangladesh Accord on fire and building safety is one that springs to mind and involves a lot of different groups along the chain. Unfortunately, it only really came about because of a major disaster, the atrocity of mass deaths in the Rana Plaza, just as the garment industry in this country really wasn't properly reformed until the Triangle Shirtwaist factory fire a century earlier. But in the core, let me just mention another precedent or something that might be useful. In the course of our campaign, Gulf Labor, we put together a network of many different international organizations that included trade union groups like the Building and Woodworkers International and the International Trade Union Confederation, human rights organizations like Amnesty and Human Rights Watch and the UN Commission on Human Rights, and professional groups like Engineers Against Poverty, which is a very interesting group you might not know about. And lastly, NGOs like the Society for Labor and Development in New Delhi, who works very closely with worker groups in the sending countries. And this was a network that we shared a lot of information and shared tactics. And obviously, there are many of these organizations that have vast community, vast constituencies internationally, and a lot of expertise in this area. And we brought all these people to the table in our negotiations with the Guggenheim Museum leadership, which lasted for 6 years altogether. But latterly, we brought all these organizations to the table and more or less invited the leadership to work with this network in an effective way. And unfortunately, they declined to do so. They walked away. And so our campaign is a little bit dormant right now. But that network, that coalition of partners, we felt was the best. I mean, not the only. Not the only membership you could put together, but one of the best coalitions of organizations that could deal with this problem. But if there was a similar, if you could translate that into a setting that would speak to the needs and goals of the architectural profession, if you wanted to move forward, then I think it's that kind of network that might be very useful to think about. It could be reactivated. Could be open to adding other organizations, so that's just leave on that note with that suggestion that is worth thinking about. Thank you.
Thanks, Andrew. And I want to add my compliments to the Build Your Architecture team. You guys have come a long way since that informal chat we had in 2013, but I was really honestly wondering what I was doing there amongst that group. At that time, I was heads down acting as a technology vendor, making stuff. My roles changed a little bit now, but in reading the report and listening to the discussions today, it occurred to me that there's an enormous confluence between the work that this team has been doing and these larger questions of what the agency of architects is in the systems that we operate in. That and a lot of my professional work and my research has been about this relationship between the supply chain, the agency of the architect, and how technology is an intermediary between those things. And I think this discussion really raises some interesting questions about whether there could be a transition in the architect's role in answering questions about labor and supply chain from one of kind of advocacy. And I would put all that stuff related to the AIA and AIA code of ethics into a stack called the advocacy stack, which is less interesting because, frankly, the AIA is less interesting. And more toward questions of whether or not we could be in positions of influence or even control over the process. That's going to require the rethinking of some relationships that are pretty fundamental. The architects have, at least for the last 50 or 60 years, had a very ambivalent relationship to the delivery supply chain. We have not been active in the design of those systems, and we've largely allowed ourselves as agents to be defined by these larger systems. of delivery. And it didn't occur to me until Mabel was talking today that, at least through the lens of American practice, there is an explicit separation between the architect's role and the architect's responsibility for labor on the construction site. It comes from a lawsuit that was filed in the 1960s when a construction worker in Chicago was killed digging an elevator pit. And there was a question. At that point, up to that lawsuit, architects and contractors had divided up their work between design and means and methods, largely as a matter of convenience. You know, when the Empire State Building was built, the architect had 200 construction managers working for the firm. And it was and this division of labor between intention and execution was largely an arrangement of logistical convenience until that particular moment when the forces of liability came to the fore and the American design profession decided that the only way they could insulate themselves from that kind of exposure was to emotionally and technically separate ourselves from the means and methods of construction. And so that's now become instantiated into the sort of very fundamental activities that architects take on, and the responsibilities, frankly, that we take on. And it is a very clear dividing line. It's a very clear dividing line that has created a separation that is structural in nature and has been called into question now in the era of kind of modern digital and representational technologies. So while a lot of the discussions around the role of technology in this context has to do with the precision of representation and transactional clarity and the ability to create and fabricate exotic forms, there's in this context there's actually an interesting opportunity to attack that intent versus execution question, which has its origins in the American architecture profession. In a labor separation. And it will be a long time before the large-scale systems of delivery by which these kinds of projects that we're talking about are changed, because they are changed by neoliberal capital forces that are way beyond the control of the architect. Architects are two orders of magnitude too small to influence those systems themselves. But what we can do is we can choose certain vectors through that system to pick where we can have influence. At the beginning of that process of design and design ideation are choices about strategies, about systems, about materials, over which the architect has an enormous amount of control and domain, should we choose to exercise that control throughout the sort of the system of the supply chain. So the strategy that it seems to me that makes sense and would be a logical elaboration of the propositions that have been put forward in the report would be for us to systematically and carefully choose specific vectors through the supply chain where we know we can influence the endpoint, which are the people who are actually executing the work on the ground. And that can be through choices of certain kinds of systems, strategies about prefabrication or off-site construction, arbitraging materials, and these are all strategies that can be instrumentalized by technology, but are going to require us as architects to have a different attitude about the way we actually make stuff. So I found the diagrams about building information modeling in the report to be kind of interesting because they're very romantic, right? There's a romantic vision that somehow technology is going to magically integrate the dog's breakfast of data and processes that result in the construction of a complex building. And, I mean, I thought they were charming, but they might have been a little bit reductive. But they do present an opportunity on a couple of different fronts. The thing that an idea like building information modeling presents us as architects is an epistemological structure that we can use to control the information flows of design. Setting aside all your complaints about the efficacy of the technology itself, it's a knowledge system. It's a way of controlling the flow of information out to its endpoints. So representational strategies that are clearer about the way things are made, more transparent, all the way out to the job site can be exploited using a platform like building information modeling. There's a whole constellation now of other technologies that are about understanding, prediction, and analysis. Being able to really see what you're going to do, predict what you're going to do before you do it. And my view of this is that today, most of the technologies that we use are exploiting questions of geometry and materiality, but that the newer simulation opportunities that are out there are actually about human activity. And instead of material optimization, I think you're going to start seeing a more advanced project teams using technologies to do things like labor optimization. It's now possible to use a combination of a building information modeler and an analysis engine and a gaming engine and actually simulate the physical activities that are going to go on a site. That will change the nature of labor as a resource on a construction site from something that's frankly heavily commoditized in these kinds of projects that we're talking about to something that has to be managed and designed. And then we as architects can, by choosing systems and materials and construction strategies, we can actually extend our reach out into those things and try to exploit those technologies accordingly. The other opportunity that's emerging because of these technologies that are more easily available to architects now is under this broad umbrella that's starting to be called industrialized construction, which is the pre-making of things and the bringing of those things onto a site. And you can, the trucks example was an early example, but the systems are starting to become more aggregated and more heterogeneous, and architects make those decisions a priori. So if you make those decisions in a way such that you understand the labor implications of them and make choices in the supply chain that privilege the more labor advantage strategies, and that's how we can reach through the, I think I counted 7 jumps between. And you left the design architects out, right? So if you're Frank Gehry, he has to jump through the associate architect, then to the client, then to the CM, then to the contractor, the sub-subcontractor, the labor provider. You're like 8 degrees of separation away. But you get to make decisions at the beginning of the process that can influence these things, but it's going to require a degree of conceptual and legal intestinal fortitude that, frankly, at least the American architecture profession is only beginning to understand. So I would have not expected that this kind of discussion would have brought me to these kinds of conclusions, but it's pretty clear that in some form, combined with a commitment, the instrumentality of some of the new emerging technologies gives us some opportunities to address these questions that I think this team is so well articulated and brought to the fore. So thanks for the opportunity to think about it.
Well, thank you, Mabel, Kadambari, Jordan, Tiffany, Nora, and Andrew. It's been really fascinating, I think, as Phillip has said, to watch the evolution of WBYA. So I'll read my very short statement that I added to the guidebook and then open it up. It's called The Other Maker. In 2002, the first fabrication laboratories were launched at MIT. After decades of digital research and development, this reinvestment into making, enabled by a grant from the National Science Foundation, was intended to help technology institutes in developing countries acquire the tools and knowledge to build their own products and design small-scale interventions with the power to have large-scale impact. For architects and architecture students across the United States in particular, this signaled the end of the seminal, quote, paperless studio, which started at Columbia's GSAPP in 1994, throwing the field into a swirl of conceptual practices, formal experiments, and exquisite virtual representations. These constructed worlds have been continuous, fluid, smooth, topological, scaleless, infinite, and immaterial. As fab labs took off within architecture schools, material assemblies, construction methods, tools and tooling were ushered back, surfaces were now visibly saccadic and made of individual pieces and parts, gradually morphing into an infinite number of connections and interruptions, constructing incomplete and finite holes. The architect was reconnected to her craft, with no middleman standing between the virtual and the material, except for the perfectly human-less printers and robots. In 2016, the 15th Venice Architectural Biennale, curated by Alejandro Aravena, entitled, quote, Reporting from the Front, presented an unfettered celebration of this material return as it assembled architects and architecture responding to the call to engage the world and the urgent issues of our time. Against the technologically driven machine aesthetic of the, quote, global north, and the metal studs and sheetrock panels that were enlisted to build the biennial prior, an uncomfortable aestheticization of the global south emerged as careful bricklaying, primitive hut making, and precious earth casting techniques were deployed throughout the exhibition. Undermining the Biennale's important and welcome call, this renewed engagement with the real instead soon became an alibi for a renewed fetishization of the, quote, local, of authenticity and tradition, and of craft and materiality. While reconstructing the romantic narrative of architecture as unmediated building experience and practice, the Biennale reinstated, not unlike the promise of the Fab Lab, the same nostalgic longing for a long ago disappeared architect as craftsman, finally reconnected with his poetic object. In 2012, WBYA launched an ongoing research project into the design and building of global architectural icons. Neither nostalgic nor romantic, WBYA firmly grounded its inquiries within the realities and demands of scale, even as it also underscored the importance of reconnecting architecture to its material realities. Like the Fab Lab or the Architect Craftsman, the resulting WBYA Critical Field Guide enlists the same fundamental attachment architects have to the making of their objects, but instead blows up and expands the space in between, rendering visible the vectors of interconnected actors, human and material, that constitute the complex web of global architectural practice and discourse today. Simultaneously zooming out and away from the architect's abstracted object and zooming into the realities of its making. The WBYA Critical Field Guide registers through drawing and writing the infinitely complex and invisible journey of the architect's alter ego, the quote, other maker, living and working on the other side of that same object, and with his or her own story and aspirations for the transformations it affects upon his or her life. Drawing connections across scale and site as it projects symmetries where there are none, the WBYA Critical Field Guide is a critically important and urgent contribution to the future of architectural thinking, practice, and education, as it invests the lines we draw as educators, scholars, students, and practitioners with the power to represent the realities we engage in our part of, and thus with equal power to change them. So I wanted to kind of bring this to the question of education, and I think part of the kind of strength and fantastic foray that the guidebook does is precisely at school, for those of you making things there, is this kind of intimate connection. But of course, the moment you're launched into practice, that intimacy is gone. And I think for the first time, we're starting to kind of map that sort of scale of connections that we are just a very tiny part of. And I appreciated, you know, whether advocacy or having a kind of sense of where to push in terms of inflection points in the kind of making process. I think all of these are really fascinating strategies that we can now start to unpack thanks to some of the research that this team has done. I think it is obviously a really important time, and it's been coming up in so many conversations post-election, a time to understand what is both the agency and also the possible advocacy that architects can take within their kind of practice and expertise. How do we, you know, what are the different forms of organization? Artists always seem to be able to get organized. I mean, even kind of post-election, there's already a kind of movement of artists, and yet for us we have AIA. It was a kind of really slap in the face. I think, you know, the only comment that comes up is something that we don't, that many of us certainly did not feel represented in. And so, you know, what are ways to think through all of these? Putting a research like that, it brings these questions into consciousness. Make these connection visible? I think the question of ethics is certainly one that is sort of urgent and very, very complicated. And so this is a kind of beginning of how we start drawing the lines and like opening up the complexities, because it's really not simple, as a kind of someone involved in practice and who also, as part of the system, didn't get paid, almost went bankrupt. We are also part of that system of exploitation and abuse in some ways, but so far the position has always been you don't say it and you're going to make it, right? So it's like, as long as you don't go under and you make it, well, you're the one. But we're seeing that the Starkitects generation may be the last generation that was able to do that, and it's much more complicated for us. Technology is changing how we work, what are the expectations, how you will work, expectations in terms of speed, in terms of delivery, in terms of fees. It's a kind of at a different scale. I don't want to make, like I said, symmetries where they are not. But I think it does help to create a sense of connection, to understand that it is all connected. On the question of the means and methods and responsibility, I can assure you that even if a contractor doesn't follow your drawings and the building leaks, it is still the architect's fault in the mind of whoever the client is. And so maybe we can take the sense of the, we are still there even though we are not contractually there, to flip it on its head a little bit. And then the last thing which maybe I want to say is to tie it a little bit to my own research as it relates to the question of the Arab city and representation, which maps out a little bit the shift of power through real estate between the old centers and the new centers. Let's say, Beirut, Damascus, Baghdad, and then Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Doha, etc. It's not a coincidence that the old centers are getting destroyed while the new ones are rising, and real estate and architecture has something to do with it. But I was kind of very disappointed to hear someone like Ben Poole say, among the many things he says, that why should we criticize? We should give the Gulf a break, because they are at least trying to find a way to bring together modernity and Islam. And this is like such a slap in the face of history and the long engagement of the Arab world with modernity and modernization as a kind of progressive, secular, modernist project that was constantly crushed by the West. And what we have left now is questions of religion and Orientalism and, et cetera, et cetera. I can go on. So all of this is interconnected, and the kind of production of these meanings. So the fact that we are left with bringing together Islam and modernity is very sad. So anyway, these are my thoughts, and I will of course continue to support this effort, and it is really great, and I think it's great that you are asking these difficult questions, so thank you.
So one thing. Can you hear me? Can everybody hear me? Do we have to use this because it's being recorded? Is that okay? Thank you. For, I think, an amazing response, because you have been our interlocutors over the course of this project. And I think, as Phil pointed out, we didn't know when we started working on this. And so it really has been, for us, an educational project, which is part of the reason why we wanted to produce the primer, because we didn't know anything, and we felt that, okay, this is one vehicle, like this is one outcome of the project. And I think, Andrew really touched upon the kind of question of activism in politics and how these questions can be engaged in that arena. I think Phil rightly brought out, one of the things that we realized, that it's both professional and economic, and that's one area of engagement. And Amale clearly, brought to bear the questions that we all had coming out of an educational institution, like what can we learn about this question in order to begin to understand how we can transform these conditions under which we're all accountable. And I guess I'm going to just ask my collaborators, what have we learned out of this project after, after 5 years? Just like, because we just, it's true, we started with that event and it just kept going. It's just like, well, what about this? And what don't we know? And who can we, and we talked to, you know, a number of offices. We talked to FX Fowl, we went to SHOP, we, you know, we talked to Human Rights Watch folks, we, yeah, I mean, we talked to lawyers. And what's interesting is the latest thing that we're working on is Who Builds Istanbul. It's amazing because precisely, I think, what Phil described, there's no firewall between architects and contractors. So there's a completely different organization between how building happens, and some of the questions that come up are precisely about, well, how do workers learn on site, what forms of delivery and how that can lead. And in a way, architects also don't have liability. I mean, it's a very, very different kind of environment of construction, but no less ruthless. Precisely because one of the issues have to do with labor murders and the number of deaths on construction sites in Istanbul. So it seems that every time we move into a new arena, we learn a whole host of things that then reflect back onto where we are. So I'm leaving the floor.
Okay. I think one of the things that I've learned really has to do with sort of understanding the chain from the architect to the contractor to the subcontractor, and to start to be able to think about how that relationship between the architect and labor is really sort of divided up, and so it's very difficult for them there to be a sort of direct relationship. And this, I guess, a sort of way of working against that system is something that Andrew was saying, which I think is really important to think about collaborations and how the discipline collaborates with you know, with human rights organizations, but also, you know, labor groups in South Asia, or you know, just all, or maybe thought, you know, it's I think there's a model of the discipline sort of looking outward into different allies, which is a very sort of hot, it's very difficult to think about how to deal with this system because it's vast, and it's very historically entrenched, and it goes back to colonial labor. And, but I think that collaborative model really opens up a way to move forward.
Yeah, I think when I first started this research project, I was just graduating from school or in school. So I think it seemed so far away, the idea of labor on these construction sites seemed so far away at that time. But now, kind of being in the workforce and entering into working at larger firms and smaller firms, I think it's an important thing to start thinking about now as a student, because you will soon be working for firms, large or small, and having an impact on the labor that's producing the work that you're developing. So I think now, when I'm drawing details as an architect, drawing even small things like millwork details or things that somebody's going to be building, I think it's always, it just kind of keeps it fresh in my mind to keep thinking about how, how the people that are going to be building this are producing it.
Okay, I'll just say something about the role of institutions, perhaps, was something that I think we can potentially talk more about, especially with some of you who are in the audience. And maybe I'll mention one thing. So in Istanbul, when we Mabel and I, when we first went to visit before we did the workshop, we came across this really interesting group of recent graduates and students. Architects who are working in big firms or, you know, changing their jobs every 2 years. And one of the things they wanted to do was actually, as recent or young employees or students, form a union. But there actually wasn't one, so they joined the construction union, which was really interesting, I thought, that they actually, you know, took that step. But I come back, and when we met with them, what was also interesting, that they really didn't have places to meet, actually had their meetings. And so that was something we encouraged Studio X in Istanbul to you know, take a role. And I think that as universities, if we do have these global centers, you know, in these different cities, and perhaps universities and institutions can just play this simple role by giving a space for all these different constituencies to meet. So that was one. The other thing I wanted to also say that I wanted to talk about, but I sort of left behind, was when we did the exhibition at the Art Institute of Chicago, our first idea was really to take as an element, that's a project designed by Renzo Piano, as some of you might know, and we really wanted to take a building element, let's say a skylight, in that building, because our mandate was to really, how do you explain these complex processes of architecture to a general public? So we thought, well, why don't we just take a part of the building and really try to draw the kind of these various networks and to show how this skylight was built, where did the materials come from, where did the workers come from, etc. It sounded very kind of apt to us. But surprisingly, that was nixed, not by the curators. The curators loved the idea. But the legal team in the institute completely nixed that idea, and I'm still not sure why. I think one of the there is sort of a pending lawsuit. Of course, all roads lead to lawyers, if I can say so. I don't know if that was the reason, but I do feel that with cultural institution, perhaps there is, you know, this sort of resistance. I mean, when we see a film, right, we wait till the end of the film and there's this long roll of credits that, you know, down to every single extra and cameraman, the name shows up. And somehow that information is not completely accessible to the public for architectural projects. Anyway, I'll pass this on to you.
Okay, so not wanting to rehash what everyone else said. We had a meeting, one of our early meetings, and members of Human Rights Watch were there. And the conversation tends to go from a problem of architecture and labor to like the endless oppression of global capitalism really quickly, like one step, and it's like you can't do anything. But in a room with people who are actively pursuing human rights abuses all over the world, their advice, which we still repeat to ourselves, was to just take very small steps and take off very small chunks and know what you can about that and try to address that. So, which is maybe a more positive way of saying that these things take time to change. But just knowing how slow changes occur, but knowing that it's very incremental, and to kind of not lose hope was a really, like, that was the best thing we could have heard. It's like, it's not about global capitalism. It's about little practices that you do every day. It's about kind of educating yourself and trying to create platforms that can educate other architects and students. And that's the step. It's not fixing the problem immediately. It's addressing the kind of immediate issues that you can.
The panel.
I'll start with one question. There's addressing this issue of kind of incremental change. I think there's been a tension, I think, in activist work, and sometimes we describe this work as activist work, sometimes it's a pedagogical project, sometimes it's an architectural project, but it sits kind of somewhere in there. On how to kind of grasp agency. And I think maybe having Andrew and Phil and Amale here can talk about the different aspects of how to address these projects at different venues. I mean, there's one idea of a kind of labor opposition, unionization, strikes, saying no, or kind of preferring not to. And there's an idea that we can kind of innovate into creating solutions that might, as well as create these vectors that can address the problem in a different way. And then there's, of course, the long project, the kind of long journey of education, trying to do a generational shift. And I think maybe I'll ask the panel and then the audience too to kind of think about how those three things work in concert to each other, because that's often how we've been thinking about it, and kind of a proposition to go forward. So that's a completely vague question, but we'll ask it or pretend like that was a question.
So, do you want to pretend that you have an answer? Or?
Well, I think that the broader framework for your question and everything we've been discussing is the big challenge of doing cross-class political work and building any kind of cross-class relationship is the biggest challenge in any organizing field, labor or otherwise. And that's the sort of, that's what's underpinning this discussion in many ways. It's also an initiative that crosses lines of nationality and often highly racialized lines of nationality. So this is Kadambari's evocation of this incident where the designers joined the construction industry was very suggestive to me, because it reminded me of what happened in this country during the 1930s when the CIO developed a great organizing drive and industrial unionism was swept into prominence to replace the old craft model of unionism, which really observed these very strict lines of demarcation between skilled workers and unskilled workers and craft workers and semi-professionalized workers within an industry, swept that old model away and made way for everyone in this industry belongs to the same union. And that didn't go up the skill chain as far as it should have done, but it went pretty far up there. And that was a model that was very much in the saddle in the driver's seat for much of the post-war period in this country, and then it got demolished by the internationalization of production. It began in the 1970s. It became much more difficult to maintain that kind of cross-class coalition. And so, in a sense, what we're trying to do here is bring that conversation around and try to think about how to reconstitute that the big industrial union. I mean, across national lines and across all of these barriers that are now in its way. If you think about it in large-scale terms, that's what this conversation is about. And of course, it's very difficult for folks at the top end of the skill chain to speak to people at the bottom end. In our Gulf labor campaign, we actually made the efforts to go out and do field research. We visited labor camps. We did interviews with workers, not just in labor camps in Abu Dhabi, but also in source countries, in India. Especially, we sent field organizers out to do these interviews. So we did establish some relationships with workers. Some of us were banned from entry into Abu Dhabi, which made it a little more difficult to do that that kind of work. But we're still trying to figure out how to build a platform, a digital platform, that will allow workers to be in contact not just with us, but also with their peers, and help their organizing efforts in some way. That's kind of rudimentary. That's about as far as we got in terms of building up that conversation. It's very difficult because there's all these obstacles that are put in your path. But that's the kind of thing that really needs to happen. And yes, it is in the spirit of breaking out of the insularity of a profession and the mentality of the profession, even at the very same time that the insularity provides insulation from the legal liability. That's the paradox of this particular circumstance. But I think, yes, I do salute the spirit of opening up and collaborating and building conversations and relationships across the entire chain.
Well, and as you were asking your question, Jordan, it occurred to me that another way to attack the system is from within its internal economics. Construction, almost anywhere, including in this country, is unbelievably inefficient and wasteful. And there's a lot of money on the table available from attacking the inherent inefficiencies of construction. And one of the reasons that you have these enormous labor abuses in countries that are not accustomed to building Western-style buildings is because they don't have any of the systems in place to build those buildings, and so they solve the problem with the cheapest, most commoditized available resource, which is an infinite supply of cheap labor. But if you can torque the system in a way that you attack the inefficiency problem and simultaneously eliminate the demand for that kind of labor, or create demand for a different kind of labor, then you might be able to torque it at the same time from the inside. I mean, I think your thought about chunking the problem into small pieces and attacking it from different directions is correct, and this is one direction. You know, if we said to the guys that built, you know, the Burj Khalifa, and it cost, what, $2 billion, well, you know what, guys, you left $300 million on the table because of all of the inefficiencies of that project, that will even attract their attention, right, to go after that $300 million with a different labor strategy. That's going to require some systemic design innovation that's a lot different than napkin sketches handed to international construction management firms.
I also like Jordan's chip away every day. I think just for me very personally, I think when I showed up at that workshop, you know, it was a bit of a surprise. There was a sense of urgency, there was a sense of importance, there was a sense of being overwhelmed and how you even start to enter into the conversation, especially if you're practicing and that is like on an everyday basis there are questions like that are emerging. But suddenly it came into our consciousness in the same way that now we have a different way of drawing details, and I can't say that we can always be, we're not, you know, we have our hands dirty very literally, but I think to ask the question, who's going to build this, how is it going to be built, where are people coming from, and if, you know, at some point I think if enough people start to ask these kinds of questions, so just that, making that visible, bringing that to consciousness, I think has already been quite important, and I can only imagine that it will. It was just not as feasible, I would say.
I do want to say the image of the strike, that labor union in Chatis, that was the labor union that has architects as a part of it. So so it's a really different, I mean literally it's just a different construction industry in terms of how people move forward. But there was an interesting architect, Alexis, I cannot remember her last name, who talked specifically about what you were mentioning, Phil, around you know, thinking through the detail to basically ask for a certain kind of skilled work that could be done as a way of thinking about how do you train workers to move from unskilled to skilled. And so she's saying, yes, that's the kind of work we can do in the office. She runs a very small office, actually. But she's thinking about these as strategies for changing what's actually happening on
construction. Yeah, there's also an economic development dimension to this. Like, in Singapore right now, they've decided that the construction industry is too dependent on foreign workers. It creates too precarious a circumstance there. So they're starting to develop industrialized construction infrastructure as a matter of economic development. They're building they're moving the port, and they're building these precast concrete factories, and they want to be the precast concrete center of Asia construction. So they want to be like the manufacturing center for that. So if there were some way to do that, to take that kind of an idea, and move the work to the village instead of vice versa, you'd have a completely different model. That would be really interesting.
Yeah, and we were just laughing because ironically, one of the main sources for those housing modules is Singapore in terms of concrete.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So we're just going to open it up to questions from
I had a really quick question that builds on what Andrew said about like imagined areas and structures of sort of solidarity across class, across international, et cetera, and thinking about also how long this project has gone on. I'm curious if, one, you've traced any change in the tone of people's shoulder shrugging from the beginning to now, with that term specifically when you asked them about this set of problems, if that has changed, and which I would imagine one way or another it might have. And if, in that context, if any of your work has aligned or been coordinated with the work of a group like Art Teacher Lobby that's working more directly, I mean, involving some of these people in the project, I'm just curious, you know, basically in the spirit of Andrew's question, like, are you all thinking or working on how to, how the imaginary of solidarity within the office, say, or within this country between architects could or should be aligned with the labor of people elsewhere? Very much in the project, I'm just curious if you're tracing any changes and what you're thinking about modifying that in your project as well.
I can answer maybe part of it. I think a lot of the people we approached at the beginning, there was a lot of shoulder shrugging, but I think as the years have gone by, and feel free to correct me if it's not quite your impression, that people are interested, that it is not something that that architects or universities or institutions want to ignore. Often the question is like, it's not that we want to ignore it, it's that we can't address it directly. I think this occurred in Chicago, that there was some reason, whether it was legal or there was a relationship between piano and the institution that they didn't want to disrupt, that it was easier to say no and kind of direct the project into something else. But I think, you know, we've been to Istanbul and been involved in biennials and in Venice and at these major institutions, there is an audience and people are showing up. And so the question then is how to take that and kind of convert it into a much more broader idea of action. And I think that's something that we still struggle with on one hand, and we're still developing the best ways to take people's genuine concern and their desire to do something and what that is. So I think a lot of, I don't think there's really any architecture offices that want their projects to be built with exploited labor. And so the questions of how to address that still remain really cool. And yeah. The other questions?
I mean, not direct answer, but related is that I think also what we see from the present moment is that labor, there's such an urgency in these questions around labor. But if labor continues, you know, as we've seen the sort of invisibility of labor, and then that invisibility, you know, can be manipulated towards you know, its ingenuous and malicious ends. And so I think this sort of opens up a moment where having a conversation around labor in the discipline can connect to some of the other issues that we're facing. So hopefully that will, you know, because just even, you know, things that were said today, that really sort of opens up new possible directions. And so I think we're having more people involved in the conversation, you know, can move the work forward in ways that we couldn't have envisioned.
Yeah, I just wanted to add a footnote. In our first forum, we invited Peggy precisely because of the book she had done with Phil, Recasting Labor, and one of the things that Peggy kept saying, Andrew, you were there, she's like, well, what I don't understand is how are architects going to understand labor when they have bad labor practices within their office, right? And she kept saying this, like, and that's actually where Architecture Lobby came from, was from that panel, because she kept trying to bring to the fore, it's not just over there, it's in our own offices. And, you know, and she felt like, you know, we have to raise a level of conscience about what labor is in our own local practices in order to change where they are elsewhere.
So just, is there a way to hitch, I don't know what direction it goes, but hitch your wagons to one another? You know, it just seems like to me, I imagine these conversations with firms here, but with individuals, there's more agency to control your own, like whether it's limited still, you can think about labor much more concretely in terms of your own and practices in your office. So if that conversation develops in a certain way, I just wonder how it can or should align conversation about labor elsewhere.
I think kind of following from what Jacob's just brought up, one of the discoveries in the project early on was that the projects that tend to have the worst labor conditions are those that are maybe more invisible than the cultural projects that that we are kind of connecting with, and like maybe architects aren't involved in those. And I just wonder if the project has any ambitions to kind of engage the mega construction firms aside from maybe the architects as, and not just from a sort of like perspective of organizing the laborers, but like how do you guys get in the heads of the people who maybe aren't architects and like aren't participating in this discussion and get them aware? I mean, aside from, I really appreciate Phillip's comments about the sort of economic advantage and the things that you said too, but that like goes for development.
Right, but I mean, that is a particularly daunting problem. Because at least we as architects have a view through, you know, when I make a decision about a certain curtain wall system, if I'm conscious about it, I can think about what it means. But these global construction consortiums, you know, that contractor who's building that building is probably a subsidiary of a subsidiary of a Spanish construction consortium who makes its money not building buildings, but arbitraging capital between building projects and arbitraging material prices. They're not even in the business of building things.
Yeah.
They just move money around and keep some of it. So trying to get their heads wrapped around this problem is a really much greater challenge than getting our heads wrapped around it. I don't have a glib answer for you. Do you have a good answer? Because I don't
have a
good answer. I have a good answer, but let me give you one example of a large international construction conglomerate like this. I mean, they're based somewhere, and this one happened to be based in Holland. And we found out that they had a master agreement, internationally binding, with the Building and Woodworkers International Union. And this firm had actually been commissioned to build a stadium in Abu Dhabi. And so that agreement, that master agreement, applies to Abu Dhabi. And it's an agreement that does encourage worker organization and worker representation at every level. And we discovered this, and it flies in the face of the official position in the UAE that there are no trade unions, and trade unions are illegal in the UAE. So the internationality, that aspect, opens up other possibilities when you're dealing with countries that are very illiberal, let's say. If you can find the leverage point. But again, just to go back directly to your question, approaching architects on an individual basis and appealing to their conscience probably is not going to get you very far. They're not like artists who have a kind of solo, I mean, they believe they fly solo, and in many cases they do. And an act of conscience is something that's a mark of integrity for them. A lot of professional architects, of course, are part of firms, and what they do and what they say has a lot of implications for hundreds of people who are employed in the firms. And so that can make those comments very consequential. And it means you're isolated, you're cut off from commissions, you're not invited, or you're excluded from bids, and so on and so forth. So it's very important then to be able to say, as you're going to have that conversation, to say, look, there is this chain of groups that is involved at this point, and they represent at every level of the industry, and you're not on your own. You're not vulnerable within your own profession either. I think that's the important connection to make, and that's the work that I would think at this point has to be built on. In a way. It's not impossible.
Hi, thank you so much for your insights. I really appreciated this discussion. Just two quick questions. One is, to what extent is the counterpart to this question, who is your architecture for? And presenting that not so much as kind of an additional obligation, because I think if you open that in architecture, it's an actual, you know, public aspect that can go endlessly, can be recursive. But in a strategic way, I wonder if that could be a question that actually is inextricable from asking who builds your architecture. Because in asking who is this for, what is this for, I think it might highlight potentially in some ways the people at the site currently and as it's, you know, as it's being produced, and to what extent are they part of this or in the, you know, future production of this site. And then the second question is a bit more abstract. It has to do, I appreciate the Jordan's insight as to kind of this incremental approach, which really is asking the question of how do we ask in every project that we do, what is the ethic at every step, I think is what you're saying. And kind of, I don't know, that made me think a bit about what Phil is saying regarding building information modeling and all the software that kind of comprises the first immediate interface that a lot of architecture students have with building. And so that's actually been a question that I've been interested in is to what extent is the, are there questions that are possible to be explored by considering the media through which architects are producing these fantastic works. One thing I was wondering though is with the idea of kind of endlessly or asking what data isn't there, or as you proposed, Phil, with increasingly transparent, making rendering transparent the supply models through the software, is if there's a danger in kind of focusing on this idea of transparency, which is another kind of fetishization of the real, and also on focusing in terms of in speaking continuously in terms of systems designing and better systems, there's something at odds with that and politics, in the sense that to design systems is trying to kind of create this closed loop that resolves those questions in a way that technology has this tendency of becoming accepted as politically neutral versus this kind of this other aspect. I think with with what Kadambari is saying, with maybe it's more about having sites where conflicts can arise, where different languages and different mistranslations can happen. But just kind of what might be, things to consider in approaching those different strategies.
Okay, who wants to unpack that?
Yeah, of course. So, the first question about who is your architecture for? I think that I really like that sort of that question, because it a lot of the projects that we were looking at in Qatar, a lot of those were being built for the World Cup, that's coming up. And I think we've seen, with in Brazil, for example, there were so many protests around the cost of those projects and how that money could have been spent in other ways. And so to what extent is the state basically directing capital to these projects that are for these sort of single events and then are no longer used? And so I think that, and I don't know the answer, but I think that it's sort of, again, maybe in thinking about how architecture connects and architects connect to different groups. There's the sort of the citizens who are asking, why do we have this architecture? What is it being used for?
Yeah. So does that mean I have to take the second half? Or are we skipping to the next question?
Well, I wanted to add to that question, perhaps.
The second half or the first half?
The second half of the question. Okay. Which I applaud very much, I'm going to agree with, is that I think in some of the discussions about labor and managing labor, there's a tension between kind of historical conceptions of managed labor that lead to some of the exploitations that we see, versus another kind of idealization in progressive concepts of rationality. I think in your position in particular, there's a kind of unresolved kind of expression of the two sides of efficiency and the two sides of management. I'm a little, I think the organizational model that I'm hearing across the board seems robust and changeable, but I'm scared of this management thing.
Well, I don't want to argue that I've resolved this with a high degree of clarity, right? But where my thinking comes from, and I will stipulate that architects in particular internalize technologies by fetishizing. That's what we do. That's our process, right? We overdo it almost always. But the direction that the technologies are taking more now is more about, at least in my view, is about a deeper connection between intentionality and execution. And because right now what we use are means of extreme abstraction, right? We make diagrams, and those diagrams are progressively elaborated until they eventually end up in some form as labor instructions on the site. The acts of representation and design intent that we commit, empowered by technology, have a deeper reach and are going to continue to have deeper and deeper reaches. If we can direct that technology in a way that engages labor in some responsible fashion, then that will be good. If we're just using it as another tool of systematic oppression, then I agree with you, that's bad. We are really, really, really a far way away from that right now. I mean, I'm heavily speculating. I mean, there are no technologies right now that even, in a very rudimentary way, represent the way a thing goes together. Almost everything represents what that thing is when it's done.
I think one example I would put in front of you that maybe is slightly tangential, but is the discourse around smart cities.
Yep.
As a kind of hyper-regulated, monitored system that is somehow going to fix everything.
Yep.
And I kind of worry that that's lurking in some of the management systems you're talking about.
It might be. I mean, I think it's a perfectly legitimate observation. It might be, but what I'm kind of advocating for in a very simple way is that as these technologies expand the relationship into the supply chain, architects can try to leverage them in a way that is advantageous to this discussion that we're having. That's my only argument. It's so early that we can do that. You know, nobody's working on this problem right now. So let's work on it.
One model that came up very early on when we were looking at it, literally right at the start, had to do with the code of ethics and the green, the sustainability question. And if you look at the history of that, where it started, and now how it's just become, you know, just the part of practice, you know, things, you know, this question has come up also along the way about, well, what if you had a labor lead? You know, that you actually had points for fair labor practices, not only within a construction project, but also in the materials that you're actually using on that project. And that could be one way to sort of guarantee across the whole system a way in which labor conditions are improved across the board, and not just in construction, but also in the production of material. So I think, Patrice, you had...
I had a little further question on that, sort of following up with... What Phillip was saying in that is, I think Phillip's suggesting that what we're looking for is not a system that's going to dictate or prescribe how these decisions are made, but the objective is to continue the work that's being done by the group at finding out the information. You know, who's out there, what are the consequences, who's involved in terms of labor. And then being able to, armed with that knowledge, work with technology to provide an efficient feedback to the actual design so that you know, as Phillip says, there's currently no system that actually does determine how something goes together, but there, you know, technology is perfectly capable of taking what we propose as coming together and, you know, extracting or proposing what that formation is, and being able to put behind that formation what is involved in terms of labor consequences.
Yeah, there was a really interesting project done, unfortunately just way too early, at MIT about 12 or 15 years ago. It was a professor in their civil engineering group who had written a series of algorithms that allowed you to examine a construction project and turn a dial and optimize the same construction outcome for lowest cost, shortest time, and safest construction scenario. And those things were at odds with one another. Now, I mean, it was a really cool idea that was 15 years too early because the inputs were excruciating. But the idea was really interesting that you actually explicitly had to make decisions about whether you were going to work fast or safe. And those are the kinds of things that I think those are the kinds of things that I think are interesting, as opposed to turning every construction robot worker into a pre-programmed BIM robot, which I think would be bad. Feels bad to me, at least.
Maybe I'm missing something here, but in my experience, at least, and I've done field research in the Gulf and in China, and right now doing my research is in Palestine and Israel, wherever you have a milieu, a production milieu, where there's an abundance of labor, and very cheap labor, and very vulnerable labor, then there's no incentive to raise the technological standards. And it becomes a labor-intensive sector. It's not at all one that is conducive or receptive to advanced technology. And so, and these are the kinds of sites where the worst labor abuses happen, the labor-intensive ones, not the ones where, and they're resistant, economically resistant, in other words, to being receptive to new technological standards.
No, it's absolutely true. I was in India a couple of years ago visiting this enormous 5,000 unit condo project that was under construction, and the developer couldn't find a contractor, so he'd started his own construction company. And I said to him, we were having a BIM conversation, I said, okay, what is the biggest problem on this construction site? And you expect, you know, in this was out of kind of the twilight zone of India, you expected him to say stuff like, oh, I can't get the right kind of laborers, I can't get equipment on my site, I have construction logistics problems. He said, no, the only thing I care about is the commoditized cost of cement, which is the stuff that goes in the concrete. Yeah. If I could get the cost of cement down, I could make a ton of money, that's basically what he said. He did not give a damn about the fact that there were 2,000 guys on that site, you know, hauling buckets of water up 30 story staircases. He didn't care. So you're right, you're absolutely right.
I would say, I think we're going to have to end. It is 10 after 3, but I just want to say thank you to the panel and my collaborators for really sharing their insights in an ongoing conversation. I don't think this is over, so we look forward to you hearing, talking with you about future events. And also, please circulate information about the guide for people. So thank you.